Hi, I'm Thumbelina, and welcome to Storytime with the Fairies. Are we all ready for a fun-filled night of fairy tales and laughter? Alrighty, let's get started! Our first tale is one of love, romance, and adventure. The story of Cinderella. Once upon a time, there lived a young maiden, and her name was Grumpy! What? No, don't be ridiculous. Her name wasn't Grumpy. It was...
No! Grumpy, look! Behind you!
Good evening. My name is the moderator, and welcome to Tales of Terror. You may be wondering what happened to Thumbelina and all the other fairies and dwarves who are just here getting ready to tell you some comforting bedtime stories about love and princesses and such. I'll save you the trouble. It's all lies. You don't really think Snow White wanted to marry that prince, did you? Her life would have been better had she let the queen eat her heart. Pinocchio disobeyed his father, ran off, joined the circus, found out his father had been right, learned his lesson with the help of a cricket, and had a magical fairy turn him into a real boy. Right. Wrong. Pinocchio murdered Jiminy Cricket and did not learn his lesson. He was eventually hanged after making consistently bad decisions. Fantasy lies to you. Only in horror do you see people's true nature. These stories feature people that will slaughter for power, betray old loves, and kill just for the fun of it. As for the fairies themselves, who were just here, let's just say they went the way of Basil Hallward. Now that we've cleared that up, are you sitting comfortably? Then I'll begin.
October is my favorite month of the year. Not because I trick-or-treat, I'm too old for that. Or because I get to hang out with friends, or because of all the Halloween parties, no. No. The reason October is my favorite month of the year comes down to one thing. My father owns a haunted house, and he lets me work there every year. Nothing brings me as much joy as seeing a grown man nearly pass out because I screamed at him while wearing a costume. It's all in good fun, of course. I'm usually a peaceful guy all year long, but as soon as that sign bearing Haunted House Next Right goes up, I'm in character and ready to jump out at people. I've worked at my dad's house since I was old enough to hold a scythe. It's scary to have a zombie jump out at you, but it's even scarier to have a baby zombie jump out at you. I've enjoyed almost every year of it, too. But there's one year that stands out above all for me. One that I couldn't explain, even if I tried. I was 14, almost 15, and in my freshman year of high school, my friend Sam was working the house with me that night. I was dressed as a zombie farmer, and he was a mutated cow. The stream of people had been steady since opening. It had ranged from groups of frisky teenagers, to dads coaxing their elementary schoolers through, to middle-aged scare seekers who couldn't get their kids to join them. After jumping out from behind a barrel, Sam sat down, breathing heavily. When he finally caught his breath, he looked at me. He laughed and said, "Geez, dude, that guy almost hit me back." I remember responding, yeah, some people can get pretty violent in here. We looked up at the monitor connected to a camera in the hallway to see a group of 5 or 6 teenagers all laughing, probably making fun of the cheesy music in the first part of the house. Get ready, I hissed at Sam. He turned and crouched behind his wagon. I watched as the kids crossed the threshold into the farm scene. They all slowed down. The farm scene does that to people. The absence of immediate scares leads to the expectation of jumps. Plus, it was pretty dark in there too. They crept along, looking around, obviously very suspicious of every tractor and every hay bale. That's when I noticed the guy in the back. He wasn't like the others. He stood straight up and had the near expressionless look on his face. He didn't bounce as he walked. Instead, he just glided like he was floating. Dude was weird. I shook off an unsettling feeling and got ready to scare them. I looked over at the monitor. They were almost to the yellow line that signaled go time. A countdown started in my head, just like always. 5. I looked at the creepy floater in the back. 4. He was just floating. 3. The unsettling feeling came back faster than it had left. 2. I grabbed my pitchfork. The creepy guy looked directly at the camera. 1. He held his gaze for that last second before Sam and I jumped out. I didn't have time to process what he'd done until the rest of the group was out of the farm scene, scared half to death. However, when I jumped out, I hadn't seen him. There was the group of 5, but there was no 6th. Sam and I sat back down. I asked, "Did you see that?" And he was like, "See what?" Nervously, I peeked back up over my barrel. There was still no sign of the floater. I looked back at the monitor. He was standing there, at the yellow line, staring straight at the camera, the expressionless look still on his face. I looked over the barrel again, and again, he wasn't there. I pointed at the monitor. That. Sam looked at where I was pointing and made a comment about how creepy it was, obviously processing it in the same way I had. Slowly, the two of us stood up, both watching the expressionless teen on the monitor. More of his features came into view. His pale skin, his messy black hair, his clothes, his black jacket over his white shirt on top of his black jeans, his empty eyes. We saw ourselves move on the monitor, too. It was almost as if he was looking at us through the screen. As we shifted, his gaze followed us through the camera and remained locked on us. Slowly, we made our way out of the room. The last thing I saw of the guy was his creepy, vacant stare into the monitor's camera. We turned the corner and ran. As we left, we heard the other scarers yell, "Why are you guys here? Damn kids can't take instructions, and y'all look like you've seen a ghost." When we finally escaped the house, it caught my dad's attention. He asked, "What's going on, you guys?" Sam stuttered, but he couldn't put it into words. I looked around nervously. I remember scanning the line leading into the house, then the people leaving, and finally, the house itself. Sam continued trying to speak. It sounds stupid, but I tapped Sam's shoulder and pointed at the house. He and my dad turned to look. Up in the second floor window stood the teen. Only he didn't look like one anymore. His black hair had turned gray and his cheeks had become wrinkled. He stared at us, at me, for an unbearable amount of time. I heard Dad saying to his radio, "Someone get up to the second floor, hotel scene. A guest has found a window." Then he turned around and continued taking people's money. I knew there was no use in sending people up there, though. I simply held eye contact with the old man for what felt like an eternity, then blinked, and he was gone. The curtain wasn't moving, and none of the interior cameras showed anything. I'll never forget his gaze, though. Even though it's been years since then, I'll always remember. I haven't seen him either, not even someone who looks like him. But sometimes, while I'm asleep, I'll see the monitor in my dreams, with dark, empty eyes staring back at me, and I know he's somewhere, silently watching.
And now a scene from the Bard himself, the Scottish prey to those who are superstitious. MacBeth to everyone else.
Thrice the brinded cat hath mewed.
Thrice and once the hedge pig whined.
Harp beer cries, tis time, tis time.
Round about the cauldron go, in the poisoned entrails throw. Toad that under cold stone days and nights hath 31, sweltered venom, sleeping pot, boiled out first is the charmed pot.
Double, toil and trouble, fire burn and cauldron bubble.
Fillet of a fenny snake, in the cauldron boil and bake. I have newton toe of frog, wool of bat and tongue of dog. Alder's fork and blind worm's sting, lizard's leg and owlet's wing, for a charm of powerful trouble, like a hell broth, boil and bubble.
Double, toil and trouble, fire burn and cauldron bubble.
Scale of a dragon, tooth of wolf, which is mummy, maw and gulf, of the ravine salt sea shark, root of hemlock, digged eye the dark, liver of blaspheming Jew, gall of goat and slips of ewe, silvered in the moon's eclipse, nose of Turk and Tartar's lips, fingers of birth's strangled babe, ditch delivered by a drab. Make the gruel thick and slab, and thereto a tiger's chaudron, for the ingredients of our culture.
Double, toil and trouble, fire burn and cauldron bubble.
Cool it with baboon's blood, when the charm is firm and good.
Oh, well done, I commend your pains, and everyone shall share in the gains. And now about the cauldron sing, like elves and fairies in a ring, enchanting all that you put in.
By the pricking of my thumb, something wicked this way comes. Open locks, whoever knocks.
How now, you secret black and midnight hags? What is it you do?
A deed without a name.
I conjure you, by that which you profess, howe'er you come to know it, answer me. You untie the winds and let them fight against the churches, for the yeasty ways confound and swallow navigation up. The bladed corn be lodged in trees blow down, though castles topple on their warders' heads, though palaces and pyramids do slope their heads to their foundations, though the treasure of nature's germens tumble altogether, even till destruction sicken. Answer me to what I ask you.
Speak.
The man.
We'll answer.
Say, if the hags rather hear it from our mouths or from our masters.
Call him. Let me see him.
Poor in sow's blood that hath eaten, her nine pharaoh grease that sweetened, from the murderer's gibbet throw into the flame.
Come high or low, thyself and office deftly show.
Tell me, thou unknown power,
He knows thy thought. Hear his speech, but say thou not.
Macbeth! 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 Beware, Macduff! Beware the fate of Fife! Dismiss me enough! Whate'er thou art, for thy good caution thanks. Thou hast heart my fear aright. But one word more.
He will not be commanded. Here's another, more potent than the first.
Macbeth!
Had I 3 ears, I'd hear thee.
Be bloody bold and resolute, laugh to scorn. The power of man or none of woman born shall harm Macbeth.
Then live, Macduff. What need I fear of thee? But yet I'll make assurance double sure. Take a bond of fate. Thou shalt not live, that I may tell pale-hearted fear in lies, and sleep in spite of thunder. What is this? This rise is like the issue of a king, and wears upon his baby brow the round and top of sovereignty.
Listen, but speak not to it.
Be lion-mettled proud, and take no care. Who chafes, who frets, or where his followers are.
Macbeth shall never vanquish be until great Birnam Wood to high Dunstanane Hill shall come against him.
That will never be! Who can impress the forest, bid the tree affix his earthbound root? Sweet bodements, good! Rebellious dead, rise, never till the wood of Birnam rise, and our high-placed Macbeth shall live the liege of pleasure, pay his breath to time and mortal custom. Yet my heart throbs to know one thing. Tell me, if your art tells so much, shall Banquo's issue ever reign in this kingdom?
Seek to know no more.
I will be satisfied. Deny me this, and an internal curse on you. Let me know why sinks thy cauldron, and what noise is this?
Show.
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 Show his eyes and grieve his heart. Come like shadows, so depart.
Thou art too, like the spirit of Banquo. Down! Thy crown to sear mine eyeballs, and thy hair, thou other gold-bound brow, is like the first. A third is like the former. Filthy hags, why do you show me this? A fourth, start, eyes! What will the line stretch out to the crack of doom? Yet another, a seventh, I'll see no more. And yet the eighth appears, there's a glass which shows me many more. Some I see, that two full balls and treble scepters carry. Horrible sight! Now I see 'tis true, for the blood bolted Banquo smiles upon me and points them for his. What, is this so?
Aye, sir, all this is so. But why stands Macbeth thus amazedly? Come, sisters, cheer we up his sprites, and show the best of our delight. I'll charm the air to give a sound, while you perform your antic round, that this great king may kindly say, our duties did he welcome pay.
Where are they? Gone? Let this pernicious hour stand, I accursed in the calendar. Come in, without there.
What's your grace's will?
Saw you the weird sisters?
No, my lord.
Came they not by you?
No, indeed, my lord.
Infected be the air whereon they ride. Damn, no woe that trust them. I did hear the galloping forces. Who was came by?
'Tis two or three, my lord, that bring you word Macduff is fled to England.
Fled to England?
Aye, my good lord.
Time, thou anticipated my dread exploits. The flighty purpose never is o'ertook, unless the deed go with it. From this moment, the very first things of my heart shall be the first things of my hand. And even now, to crown my thoughts with axe, be it thought and done. The castle of MacDuff I will surprise, seize upon the fight, give to the edge of the sword his wife, his babes, and all unfortunate souls that trace him in his line. I'm boasting like a fool. This deed I'll do before, this purpose cool. But no more sights! Where are these gentlemen? Come, bring me where they are.
Never attempt fate.
That night, the Baron dreamt of many a woe, and all his warrior guests with shade and form, of witch and demon and large coffin worm, were long the nightmare. Keats. Unhappy is he to whom the memories of childhood bring only fear and sadness. Wretched is he who looks back upon lone hours in vast and dismal chambers with brown hangings and maddening rows of antique books, or upon a wed matches in twilight groves of grotesque, gigantic, and vine-encumbered trees that silently wave twisted branches far aloft. Such a lot the gods gave to me, the dazed, the disappointed, the barren, the broken. And yet I am strangely content, and cling desperately to those sere memories. When my mind momentarily threatens to reach beyond to the other. I know not where I was born, save that the castle was infinitely old and infinitely horrible, full of dark passages and having high ceilings where the eye could find only cobwebs and shadow. The stones in the crumbling corridors seemed always hideously damp, and there was an accursed smell everywhere, as of the piled up corpses of dead generations. It was never light, so that I used, sometimes, to light candles and gaze steadily at them for relief. Nor was there any sun outdoors, since the terrible trees grew high above the topmost accessible tower. There was one black tower which reached above the trees into the unknown outer sky, but that was partly ruined and could not be ascended save by a well-nigh impossible climb up the sheer wall, stone by stone. I must have lived years in this place, but I cannot measure the time. Beings must have cared for my needs, yet I cannot recall any person except myself, or anything alive but the noiseless rats and bats and spiders. I think that whoever nursed me must have been shockingly aged, since my first inception of a living person was that of something mockingly like myself, yet distorted, shriveled, and decaying like the castle. To me, there was nothing grotesque in the bones and skeletons that strode some of the stone crypts deep down among the foundations. I fantastically associated these things with everyday events and thought them more natural than the colored pictures of living beings which I found in many of the moldy books. From such books, I learned all that I know. No teacher urged or guided me, and I do not recall hearing any human voice in all those years, not even my own. For although I had read of speech, I had never thought to try to speak out loud. My aspect was a matter equally unthought of, for there were no mirrors in the castle, and I merely regarded myself by instinct as akin to the youthful figures I saw drawn and painted in the books. I felt conscious of youth because I remembered so little. Outside, across the putrid moat and under the dark mute trees, I would often lie and dream for hours about what I read in the books, and would longingly picture myself amidst gay crowds in the sunny world beyond the endless forest. Once I tried to escape from the forest, but as I went farther from the castle, the shade grew denser,
and the air more filled with brooding fear, so that I ran frantically back lest I lose my way in a labyrinth of nighted silence. So, through endless twilights, I dreamed and waited, though I knew not what I waited for. Then, in the shadowy solitude, my longing for light grew so frantic that I could rest no more, and I lifted entreating hands to the single black ruined tower that reached above the forest into the unknown outer sky. And at last I resolved to scale that tower, fall though I might, since it were better to glimpse the sky and perish than to live without ever beholding day. In the dank twilight, I climbed the worn and aged stone stairs, till I reached the level where they ceased, and thereafter clung perilously to small footholds leading upward. Ghastly and terrible was that dead, steerless cylinder of rock, black, ruined, and deserted, and sinister with startled bats whose wings made no noise. But more ghastly and terrible still was the slowness of my progress, for climb as I might, the darkness overhead grew no thinner, and a new chill, as of haunted and venerable mole, assailed me. I shivered as I wondered why I did not reach the light, and would have looked down had I dared. I fancied that night had come suddenly upon me, and vainly groped with one free hand for a window embrasure, that I might peer out and above, and try to judge the height I had attained. All at once, after an infinity of awesome, sightless crawling up that concrete and desperate precipice, I felt my head touch a solid thing, and I knew I must have gained the roof, or at least some kind of floor. In the darkness, I raised my free hand and tested the barrier, finding it stone and immovable. Then came a deadly circuit of the tower, clinging to whatever holds the slimy wall could give, till finally my testing hand found the barrier yielding, and I turned upward again, pushing the slab or door with my head as I used both hands in my fearful ascent. There was no light revealed above, and as my hands went higher, I knew that my climb was for the nonce ended. Since the slab was the trapdoor of an aperture, leading to a level stone surface of greater circumference than the lower tower, no doubt the floor of some lofty and capacious observation chamber, I crawled through carefully and tried to prevent the heavy slab from falling back into place, but failed in the latter attempt. As I lay exhausted on the stone floor, I heard the eerie echoes of its fall, but hoped, when necessary, to pry it open again. Believing I was now at a prodigious height, far above the accursed branches of the wood, I dragged myself up from the floor and fumbled about for windows, that I might look for the first time upon the sky and the moon and stars of which I had read. But on every hand, I was disappointed, since all that I found were vast shelves of marble, bearing odious oblong boxes of disturbing size. More and more I reflected and wondered what howery secrets might abide in this high apartment, so many eons cut off from the castle below. Then unexpectedly my hands came upon a doorway, where hung a portal of stone, rough with strange chiseling. Trying it, I found it locked, but with a supreme burst of strength, I overcame all obstacles and dragged it open inward. As I did so, there came to me the purest ecstasy I had ever known, for shining tranquility through an ornate grating of iron and down a short stone passageway of steps that ascended from the newly found doorway was the radiant full moon, which I had never before seen save in dreams and in vague visions I dared not call memories. Fancying now that I had attained the very pinnacle of the castle, I commenced to rush up the few steps beyond the door, but the sudden veiling of the moon by a cloud caused me to stumble, and I felt my way more slowly in the dark. It was still very dark when I reached the grating, which I tried carefully and found unlocked, but which I did not open for fear of falling from the amazing height to which I had climbed. Then the moon came out. Most demoniacal of all shocks is that of the abysmally unexpected and grotesquely unbelievable. Nothing I had before undergone could compare in terror to what I now saw. With the bizarre marvels that sight implied, the sight itself was as simple as it was stupefying. For it was merely this. Instead of a dizzying prospect of treetops, seen from a lofty eminence that stretched above around me on a level through the grating, nothing less than the solid ground. Decked and diversified by marble slabs and columns, and overshadowed by an ancient stone church, whose ruined spire gleamed spectrally in the moonlight. Half unconscious, I opened the grating and staggered out upon the white gravel path that stretched away in two directions. My mind, stunned and chaotic as it was, still held the frantic craving for life, and not even the fantastic of wonder which had happened could stay my course. I neither knew nor cared whether my experience was insanity, dreaming, or magic, but was determined to gaze on brilliance and gaiety at any cost. I knew not who I was, or what I was, or what my surroundings might be, though as I continued to stumble along, I became conscious of a kind of fearsome latent memory that made my progress not wholly fortuitous. I passed under an arch, out of that region of slabs and columns, and wandered through the open country, sometimes following the invisible road, but sometimes leaving it curiously to tread across meadows where only occasional ruins bespoke the ancient presence of a forgotten road. Once I swam across a swift river where crumbling mossy masonry told of a bridge long vanished. Over 2 hours must have passed before I reached what seemed to be my goal, a venerable ivied castle in a thickly wooded park, maddeningly familiar, yet full of perplexing strangeness to me. I saw that the moat was filled in and that some of the well-known towers were demolished, whilst new wings existed to confuse the beholder. But what I observed with chief interest and delight were the open windows, gorgeously ablaze, with light and sending forth sound of the gayest revelry. Advancing to one of these, I looked in and saw an oddly dressed company, indeed making merry and speaking brightly to one another. I had never seemingly heard human speech before, and could guess only vaguely what was said. Some of the faces seemed to hold expressions that brought up incredibly remote recollections. Others were utterly alien. I now stepped through the low window into the brilliantly lighted room, stepping as I did so from my single bright moment of hope to my blackest convulsion of despair and realization. The nightmare was quick to come, for as I entered, there occurred immediately one of the most terrifying demonstrations I had ever conceived. Scarcely had I crossed the sill when there descended upon the whole company a sudden and unheralded fear of hideous intensity, distorting every face and evoking the most horrible screams from nearly every throat. Flight was universal, and in the clamor and panic, several fell in a swoon and were dragged away by their madly fleeing companions. Many covered their eyes with their hands and plunged blindly and awkwardly in their race to escape, overturning furniture and stumbling against the walls before they managed to reach one of the many doors. The cries were shocking, and as I stood in the brilliant apartment alone and dazed, listening to their vanishing echoes, I trembled at the thought of what might be lurking near me unseen. At a casual inspection of the room, it seemed deserted. But when I moved toward one of the alcoves, I thought I detected a presence there, a hint of motion beyond the golden arch doorway, leading to another and somewhat similar room. As I approached the arch, I began to perceive the presence more clearly, and then, with the first and last sound I ever uttered, a ghastly ululation that revolted me almost as poignantly as its noxious cause, I beheld in full frightful vividness the inconceivable, indescribable, and unmentionable monstrosity, which had by its simple appearance changed a merry company to a herd of delirious fugitives. I cannot even hint what it was like, for it was a compound of all that is unclean, uncanny, unwelcome, abnormal, and detestable. It was the ghoulish shade of decay, antiquity, and desolation, the putrid, dripping eidolon of unwholesome revelation, the awful barring of that which the merciful earth should always hide. God knows it was not of this world, or no longer of this world. Yet to my horror, I saw its eaten away and bone-revealing outlines of a leering, abhorrent travesty of the human shape, and in its moldy, disintegrating apparel, an unspeakable quality that chilled me even more. I was almost paralyzed, but not too much so to make a feeble effort toward flight. a backward stumble which failed to break the spell in which the nameless, voiceless monster held me. My eyes, bewitched by the glassy orbs which stared loathsomely into them, refused to close, though they were mercifully blurred and shooed the terrible object but distinctly after the first shock. I tried to raise my hand to shut out the sight, yet so stunned were my nerves that my arm could not fully obey my will. The attempt, however, was enough to disturb my balance, so that I had to stagger forward several steps to avoid falling. As I did so, I became suddenly and agonizingly aware of the nearness of the carrion thing, whose hideous hollow breathing I half fancied I could hear. Nearly mad, I found myself yet able to throw out a hand to ward off the foetid apparition which pressed so close, when in one cataclysmic second of cosmic nightmarishness and hellish accident, my fingers touched the rotting outstretched paw of the monster beneath the golden arch. I did not shriek, but all the fiendish ghouls that ride the night wind shrieked for me, as in that same second there crashed down upon my mind a single and fleeting avalanche of soul-annihilating memory. I knew in that second all that had been. I remembered beyond the frightful castle and the trees, and recognized the altered edifice in which I now stood. I recognized, most terrible of all, the unholy abomination that stood leering before me as I withdrew my sullied fingers from its own. But in the cosmos, there is balm as well as bitterness, and that balm is Nepenthe. In the supreme horror of that second, I forgot what had horrified, and the burst of black memory vanished in a chaos of echoing images. In a dream, I fled from that haunted and accursed pile, and ran, swiftly and silently in the moonlight. When I returned to the churchyard place of marble and went down the steps, I found the stone trapdoor immovable. But I was not sorry, for I had hated the antique castle and the trees. Now I ride with the mocking and friendly ghouls on the night wind, and play by day amongst the catacombs of Neprin Ka, in the sealed and unknown valley of Hadoth by the Nile. I know that light is not for me, save that of the moon over the rock tombs of Neb, nor any gaiety save the unnamed feasts of Nitocris beneath the Great Pyramid. Yet in my new wildness and freedom, I almost welcome the bitterness of alienage. For although Nepenthe has calmed me, I know always that I am an outsider, a stranger in this century, and among those who are still men. This I have known ever since I stretched out my fingers to the abomination within that great gilded frame, stretched out my fingers and touched a cold and unyielding surface of polished glass.
And now it's time for Spooky Songs with Chloe. The part of the show when Chloe comes out and sings a spooky song.
Every time I tried to stay down, every time I tried not to reveal the deeper grave, you did. You're digging someone else now. And you just think that I'm stupid. You think I'll just bounce back like a zombie. I've been numb, but I'm not a ghost, not transparent. You can't see the mess I've been since you burned me. You just think I'm a zombie. I could eat you up, but never figure you out. I'm definitely in a warm body, but you've made me break it. I could rake it through hell and never forget you. But you'll just dig up my head one day for a friendlier. I know how much you need it when you're coming here. You just think that I'm stupid. You just think I don't see you need my one-bodied reaction. You got too cold trying not to lose. You think I don't see you wanna use me. You can't see under the dirt how much you lose. You lose my grave marker, and I won't cry just like this again. You lose my whole future, and I'm glad it was more than you could imagine when you buried me. You must think that I'm bloodless. You must think I don't feel like a zombie. I could eat you up and never, never figure you out. I know my heart was beating when you poisoned me. I know my heart was beating. If you could read my mind, you'd quit doing this for me. If you could read my mind, you'd have to bury me hard. If you could read my mind, it might break your heart. So I guess I'll just lay here a few feet down in the dark.
This has been Spooky Songs with Chloe. Join us next time to hear Chloe say,
"My mic's still working. Thank you."
The Picture of Dorian Gray. A young, beautiful man by the name of Dorian Gray has his portrait painted. In that moment, he makes a terrible, ignoble, corrupted wish. If it were I who was to be always young, and the picture that was to grow old, for that I would give everything. I would give my soul. And he does. From that day forward, Dorian Gray, while remaining young on the outside, is changed forever inside.
Alan, this is kind of you. I thank you for coming.
I had intended never to enter your house again, Gray. But you said it was a matter of life and death.
His voice was hard and cold. He spoke with slow deliberation. There was a look of contempt on the steady, searching gaze that he turned on Dorian. He kept his hands in his pockets of his Acheron coat, and seemed not to have noticed the gesture with which he had been greeted.
Yes, it is a matter of life and death, Ammon, and to more than one person. Sit down.
Campbell took a chair by the table, and Dorian sat opposite to him. The two men's eyes met. In Dorian's, there was infinite pity. He knew that what he was going to do was dreadful. After a strained moment of silence, he leaned across and said, very quietly, but watching the effect of each word upon the face of him he had sent for.
Alan, in a locked room at the top of this house, a room to which nobody but myself has access, a dead man is seated at a table. He has been dead 10 hours now. Don't stir and don't look at me like that. Who the man is, why he died, how he died, are matters that do not concern you. What you have to do is this.
Stop, Gray. I don't want to know anything further. Whether what you have told me is true or not true doesn't concern me. I entirely decline to be mixed up in your life. Keep your horrible secrets to yourself. They don't interest me anymore.
Alan, they will have to interest you. This one will have to interest you. I am awfully sorry for you, Alan, but I can't help myself. You were the one man who was able to save me. I am forced to bring you into this matter. I have no option, Ammon. You are scientific. You know about chemistry and things of that kind. You have made experiments. What you have got to do is to destroy the thing that is upstairs. To destroy it so that not a vestige of it will be left. Nobody saw this person come into the house. Indeed, at the present moment, he is supposed to be in Paris. He will not be missed for months. When he is missed, there must be no trace of him found here. You, Ammon, you must change him, and everything that belongs to him, into a handful of ashes that I may scatter in the air.
You are mad, Dorian.
Ah, I was waiting for you to call me Dorian.
You are mad, I tell you. Mad to imagine that I would raise a finger to help you. Mad to make this monstrous confession. I will have nothing to do with this matter, whatever it is. Do you think I'm going to peril my reputation for you? What is it to me what devil's work you were up to?
It was suicide, Ammon.
I am glad of that, but who drove him to it? You, I should fancy.
Do you still refuse to do this for me?
Of course I refuse. I will have absolutely nothing to do with it. I don't care what shame comes on you. You deserve it all. I should not be sorry to see you disgraced, publicly disgraced. How dare you ask me, of all men in the world, to mix myself up in this horror? I should have thought you knew more about people's characters. Your friend, Lord Henry Wharton, can't have taught you much about psychology, whatever else he has taught you. Nothing will induce me to stir a step to help you. You have come to the wrong man. Go to some of your friends. Don't come to me.
Ammon, it was murder. I killed him. You don't know what he had made me suffer. Whatever my life is, he had more to do with the making or the marring of it than poor Harry has had. He may not have intended it. The result was the same.
Murder! Good God, Dorian, is that what you have come to? I shall not inform upon you. It is not my business. Besides, without my stirring in the matter, you are certain to be arrested. Nobody ever commits a crime without doing something stupid. But I will have nothing to do with it.
You must have something to do with it. Wait a moment. Listen to me. Only listen, Ammon. All I ask of you is to perform a certain scientific experiment. You go to hospitals and dead houses, and the horrors that you do there don't affect you. If in some hideous dissecting room, or fetid laboratory, you found this man lying on a leaden table with red gutter scooped out in it for the blood to flow through, you would simply look upon him as an admirable subject. You would not turn a hair. You would not believe that you were doing anything wrong. On the contrary, you would probably feel that you were benefiting the human race, or increasing the sum of knowledge in the world, or gratifying intellectual curiosity, or something of that kind. What I want you to do is merely what you have done often before. Indeed, to destroy a body must be far less horrible than what you are accustomed to work at. And remember, it is the only piece of evidence against me. If it is discovered, I am lost. And it is sure to be discovered unless you help me.
I have no desire to help you. You forget that. I am simply indifferent to the whole thing. It has nothing to do with me.
Ammon, I entreat you. Think of the position I am in. Just before you came, I almost fainted with terror. You may know terror yourself someday. No, don't think of that. Look at the matter purely from the scientific point of view. You don't inquire where the dead things on which you experiment come from. Don't inquire now. I have told you too much as it is. But I beg of you to do this. We were friends once, Ammon.
Don't speak about those days, Dorian. They are dead.
The dead linger sometimes. The man upstairs will not go away. He's sitting at the table with bowed head and outstretched arms. Ammon! Ammon! If you don't come to my assistance, I am ruined. Why, they will hang me, Ammon. Don't you understand? They will hang me for what I have done.
There is no good in prolonging this scene. I absolutely refuse to do anything in the matter. It is insane of you to ask me.
You refuse?
Yes.
I entreat you, Ammon.
It is useless.
The same look of pity came into Dorian Gray's eyes. Then he stretched out his hand, took a piece of paper, and wrote something on it. He read it over twice, folded it carefully, and pushed it across the table. Having done this, he got up and went over to the window. Campbell looked at him in surprise, and then took up the paper and opened it. As he read it, his face became ghastly pale, and he fell back in his chair. A horrible sense of sickness came over him. He felt as if his heart was beating itself to death in some empty hollow. After 2 or 3 minutes of terrible silence, Dorian turned round and came and stood behind him, putting his hand upon his shoulder.
"I am so sorry for you, Anne,"
he murmured.
"But you leave me no alternative. I have a letter written already. Here it is. You see the address? If you don't help me, I must send it. If you don't help me, I will send it. You know what the result would be. But you are going to help me. It is impossible for you to refuse now. I tried to spare you. You will do me the justice to admit that. You were stern, harsh, offensive. You treated me as no man has ever dared to treat me. No living man, at any rate. I bore it all. Now it is for me to dictate terms."
Campbell buried his face in his hands, and a shudder passed through him.
"Yes, it is my turn to dictate terms, Anna. You know what they are. The thing is quite simple. Come, don't work yourself into this fever. The thing has to be done. Face it and do it."
A groan broke from Campbell's lips, and he shivered all over. The ticking of the clock on the mantelpiece seemed to him to be dividing time into separate atoms of agony, each of which was too terrible to be borne. He felt as if an iron ring was being slowly tightened round his forehead, and as if the disgrace with which he was threatened had already come upon him. The hand upon his shoulder weighed like a hand of lead. It was intolerable. It seemed to crush him.
"Come, Alan. You must decide at once."
"I cannot do it,"
he said mechanically, as though words could alter things.
"You must. You have no choice. Don't delay."
He hesitated a moment.
"I shall have to go home and get some things from the laboratory."
"No, Alan. You must not leave the house. Write out a sheet of notepaper, what you want. My servant will take a cab and bring the things back to you."
Campbell started nervously, and having got up from the chair, went over to the chimney piece. He was shivering with a kind of ague. For nearly 20 minutes, neither of the men spoke. A fly buzzed noisily about the room, and the ticking of the clock was like the beat of a hammer. As the chime struck one, Campbell turned around and, looking at Dorian Gray, saw that his eyes were filled with tears. There was something in the purity and refinement of that sad face that seemed to enrage him.
"You are infamous. Absolutely infamous."
"Hush, Alan. You have saved my life."
"Do not be fooled by our next tale. While it may seem innocent at first, there could be something lying underneath."
Sculptor, Part 1. Ashley. In a small, dingy apartment, Ashley stands in her bathroom in front of the mirror, leaning on the counter. Distraught and trembling, her face red and puffy, Ashley sniffles and looks at herself in the mirror, but as quickly as she looks, she turns away and closes her eyes tightly. A man in dark clothing walks slowly down the hall of the shabby apartment building. Ashley opens her eyes, never looking up. A naked razor lies on the counter next to her hands. She begins to sob.
The man stops at Ashley's door and turns his head towards it, faintly hearing the sobs from inside. Taking a steadying breath, Ashley raises the razor to her left wrist hesitantly, shaking uncontrollably. The door to her apartment is now ajar, but Ashley has no time to notice. She stops thinking, closes her eyes, takes the blade to both of her wrists swiftly, and drops the razor, shocked. She lifts both of her hands and stares at her wrists, breathing heavier still, feeling nothing yet. She watches the blood pour from the diagonal gashes, so transfixed that she doesn't notice the heavy footfalls of the stranger approaching. She turns, dizzy, and is met with a tall, dark figure standing at the door with a black bag in his hand. She hardly has time to look at him before passing out on the bathroom floor in a puddle of her own blood. The next morning, Ashley awakens under her big white comforter, faced with a bright light, unsure if she is alive or emerging from some unknown afterlife. But alas, alive she is. She opens her eyes, squinting in the morning light coming in from the blinds. She raises her arm to cover her face and notices her wrists are wrapped. She looks at her wrists and strokes her bloodied bandages lightly with her thumb. The strange man kneels in the bathroom, scrubbing the bloody floor. The only sound to be heard is the dripping of water on the bathroom floor and the abrasive scrubbing of the Scotch Brite. Why is he here? Why didn't he let me die? Why is he here? How did he get in? All of these questions race through Ashley's mind, but she hasn't the energy to move. Maybe it's the lack of blood in her body or the pills she tried to take, but either way, she was exhausted and couldn't motivate her weary bones to reach for her water glass, much less try to kick a large man out of her apartment. Suddenly, everything is quiet and still. She tries to turn over to look in the bathroom, but can't muster the strength. Anxiety climbing, she closes her eyes again, and when she opens them, he's standing in front of her. She gasps, terrified of what he might do, when he places a bowl of hot oatmeal and a glass of ice-cold milk on her bedside table. "How are you feeling?" He says it casually, as though nothing's wrong, when everything is horribly, horribly wrong. Ashley doesn't know what to say, doesn't even know how she feels. She struggles, but successfully sits upright. The man apologizes. "I'm sorry if you're confused. You were near death when I found you." "I wanted to be," Ashley snapped back at him. She didn't expect to. The man looks away awkwardly. I'm sorry, you should eat." His tentativeness makes Ashley more confident. "How did you get into my apartment?" The man fidgets, nervous. "It was unlocked. I heard you crying and I got worried." "Well, you shouldn't be here," she says, raising her voice as much as one could after losing that much blood. The man steps back a bit, retreating into himself. "You shouldn't be hurting yourself." Ashley snaps again. "You don't know anything about me. You don't understand," he interrupts her. "I think I do. You're kind of like me in a weird way." I gotta go." The man quickly turns to leave when Ashley asks, "Wait. What do you mean?" "I just know what you're feeling. We think differently than other people." He fiddles around in his pocket for a bit and pulls out a small card and a pen. He scribbles on the back and hands it to Ashley. The front reads, "Dr. Dolly, Mental Health Care Facility," with a logo shaped like a brain with a heart inside. The other side has scribbled characters of a phone number and the name Jack written above it. "She's really good, I promise. She helped me a lot. And there's my number, too." Awkward as it may be, Ashley was touched by this gesture and felt a warmth that she hasn't since her mother died. Jack turns quickly and heads for the door. "Sorry, I'm late for work." Ashley strokes her bandages lightly with her thumb, contemplating as he leaves. Later that day, Ashley sits in a pristine, sweet-smelling waiting room. Looking around the room, she sees a myriad of patients, some completely normal-looking, some a bit strange. Some talk to their supposed caregivers, some to thin air. A young girl comes up to Ashley and puts a leaf in her lap, avoiding eye contact, and when the doctor comes out, she skitters away, tapping the backs of her hands on chairs, tables, and walls in the room. "Ashley, are you ready?" the woman says in a calming voice. Ashley stands and walks to the door, leaf in hand. Ashley sits in the big comfy chair, yet comfort eludes her, She sits stiff and upright, legs crossed and sleeves pulled down to cover her wrists, the leaf gently placed on her knee. Are you comfortable? The woman can read minds, apparently, Ashley thinks to herself. I promise I can't read minds. Just behaviors. Something we're taught in those big fancy schools that us shrinks go to. Ashley looks away, then back to her. What's my behavior telling you? Dr. Dolly takes a long drink from her tea before answering. Well, behavior can tell a lot about a person. Whether they're happy, sad, longing, or hiding something. But we aren't here for that. We're here for you. What we talk about here is what you are comfortable talking about and no more. We can chat, gossip, talk about the weather, or not at all. It's all up to you, dear. Is there something in particular that you had in mind? Ashley fidgets and looks away, biting her lip, obviously uncomfortable and unsure how to begin. You're not going to give me some test or something? Some questionnaire to analyze me or whatever? If you want. I find them to be inaccurate. It's easier to get in someone's head when they invite you. Those tests make people overthink themselves, and it's so easy to lie to a piece of paper. Much harder to lie to me. They talked for a while longer, and when their hour was up, Ashley felt socially drained and like they'd gotten nowhere. What do I owe you? Well, the first session's always free. Never get anywhere on the first one anyways. It's more of an icebreaker so we can get to know each other. I want you to feel safe here. Why would you pay money to be somewhere you don't want to be? Ashley fidgets. That makes sense. Thank you. Dr. Dolly smiles at her softly. Hey, take care of yourself, okay? Sometimes change is as simple as surrounding yourself with people that make you feel good about yourself. And don't be afraid to come back. Sitting at home, Ashley stares at the back of the business card, contemplating. Out of the corner of her eye, she sees something just inside the bathroom door. Upon closer inspection, she realizes it's Jack's bag, making her decision for her. She takes her phone from her pocket and dials his number. She almost hangs up before he finally answers. Hey, how are you? She hesitates, still contemplating calling her home invader. Hi, Jack. You left your bag. He talks rapidly, nervous. Oh, yeah, I did, huh? I'm sorry about that. I was just late for work and I didn't even realize because I was late. But then I got to work and I didn't have my things, so that's when I realized, yeah. But I work on the other side of town, so, you know. Ashley was a little weirded out by his tone, but... Okay. Well, it's easy for you to get it since you're right down the hall. Jack tried to play it cool, nerves aside. Oh, yeah, totally, yeah. I can come get it tonight. Ashley also trying to play it cool, unsure how to feel. Sure. Yeah. Jack hesitates for a while before taking a chance. Maybe we could go out to dinner after? Ashley chuckles. Did you just leave your bag behind so you could hit on me? Jack stutters, trying to recover. No. I just thought maybe you'd like the company. Ashley wouldn't mind seeing him again, though. Okay. Confused, Jack repeats her. Okay? She chuckles again. Yeah, okay. Jack chuckles nervously. Okay, cool. Yeah, I'll see you then. Cool. Bye then. Ashley hangs up the phone abruptly and starts biting her nails. While Jack might be awkward and intrusive, there's something about him that just makes her feel good. Cared about. Maybe that's what Dr. Dolly was talking about. Sitting at the restaurant, neither of them knew what to say. Ashley hasn't had much genuine social interaction in so long. Small talk seems impossible. But Ashley broke the silence. So, how was work? Jack looked up from the menu, taken off guard. You know, it was fine, other than the fact that I didn't have my bag, but... Asha didn't know how to reply, so Jack continued. Do you work? Asha looked down at the menu. Oh, you know, nothing big. I'm just an artist. Sculptor, mostly. Jack chuckles incredulously. Just an artist? What do you sculpt? She glances up from her menu briefly, flattered that he's taken any interest in her at all. Mostly busts of people or symbols of frustration. I have a studio downtown. People come in, sculpt, draw, or write something that makes them angry or sad or whatever, and destroy it. Jack's eyes widen. What? Ashley smirks a bit, surprised Jack is so entertained. Yeah. Jack raises his eyebrows and scoffs. That is the coolest thing. She looks at Jack, unconvinced. Really? Jack raises his hands, gesturing. Yeah, it's creative, and it helps people. Ashley doesn't know what to say. No one's really taken an interest in her work before. I guess. You should come down to the studio sometime. Jack looks embarrassed. I don't know. I don't have a creative bone in my body. Ashley chuckles slightly. That's not possible. Jack raises a finger pointedly. Here, I'll prove it. Jack grabs a napkin and begins to scribble. Guess what I drew? Ashley studies it for a moment, really giving it her best effort. A seal? Jack deflates just a little but smiles. It's a helicopter. She raises both of her eyebrows at him in disbelief. No, it's not. Jack combs his hand through his hair as he laughs. It is, I swear. They both share a laugh, genuine and sweet. And Ashley smiles for the first time in a very long time. You have a beautiful smile. Her smile fades and turns into a blush. Thanks. They sit and talk for what felt like hours before the waiter dropped off the check. Split it? They both said simultaneously, and they both chuckle and place their cards on the check. The air outside is cold and crisp, and Ashley takes a deep breath, letting it out in a sigh. Ashley looks up at Jack and then down quickly. I had a really good time, Jack. Jack looks away and fidgets nervously. Me too. I just feel really comfortable around you. She smiles, blushing, her face turning hot. Me too. Jack clears his throat. Here, I'll walk you to your door. They walk together through the dismal hall. When they get to her door, she looks down sheepishly. She glances up and kisses him on the cheek before quickly opening the door and stepping inside. She closes it about halfway. Good night, Jack. See you soon? Jack looks taken aback, blushing, and stutters. Yeah. Good night. She closes the door and slides down it, heart fluttering in a way she's never felt before. She sighs again deeply with a smile on her face. A few days later, Ashley sees Dr. Dolly again, excited to tell her about her night out with Jack. It was like nothing I've ever felt before. I just felt so good and, I don't know, whole. It was surreal. It's like I turned into a completely different person. He just understands me in a way that no one else ever has. You'd be surprised what a change in scenery can do for a person. I'm happy that you're feeling better, Ashley. Now that you're feeling comfortable around other people, I think you should work on being comfortable in your own skin. Go shopping. Get some new clothes. Find something that makes you feel beautiful. It doesn't matter what it is, as long as it makes you feel good about yourself. Ashley fidgets. Okay. Ashley calls Jack up right away, and this time he answers in the first ring. Hey, Jack. Are you working right now? No, I'm not busy. What's up? I just wanted to know, Dr. Dolly said I should go shopping, and I was wondering if you wanted to come. Jack sounds surprised but excited. Shopping? Yeah, I can do that. Meet you at the mall? Ashley smiles. Yeah. I'll see you there. Once Ashley stepped inside the mall, she felt so out of place. Shopping wasn't her scene, and her anxiety started to climb. She looked around desperately for Jack.
Ash!
Jack was across the way a bit, waving his arms and calling to her. She smiles and heads his way. Looking into windows, perusing shelves, nothing seemed to catch her eye, until they went past this bridal prom dress shop. Ashley gasps and lightly touches the window. On their way back to the apartment, still wearing what she got at the mall, Ashley suddenly says, "Wait, do you want to see the studio?" Jack smiles and glances at her. "Of course. Lead the way, Aphrodite." Ashley blushes and directs into the studio. Walking into the dusty old shop, Ashley turns on the lights and waits by the door while Jack gives it a once-over. "Oh, wow. This is amazing, Ash. This place is yours?" Ashley looks down. "Yeah. I got it when my mom died. There's a place upstairs, but I don't really go up there." Jack looks at her briefly before continuing looking around. "Oh, well, it's great. I mean, it's so big, and it just feels so homey." Ashley smiles, deeply appreciative that Jack wasn't sorry about her mom's death. "Everyone's always so sorry. Sorry to hear that. She's sick of it." "Thanks," she said with a genuine smile on her face. Jack fiddles with an old record player in the corner. "This thing work?" He rifles through a few records, finding a satisfactory disc and putting it in place. Yeah, my mom really liked vinyl, said downloaded music wasn't quite the same. Jack puts the needle to the disc, and once the music starts, he moves with it, dancing around the studio. Ashley giggles, and Jack bows as he reaches his hand towards her. "My lady?" Ashley raises her eyebrows. "No, no way." Jack grabs her hand and pulls her towards the center of the room. "Jack!" she scolds, but smiles, giggling and blushing. They sway, his hand on her waist, light years away in a place of peace, lost in the music and each other. They dance until the record plays through and let it skip until they come back to reality. Jack takes the needle off, still holding Ashley close. They look into each other's eyes and share a sweet and long kiss, savoring the silence and holding each other closely until they finally come up for air. Ashley, full of longing, asks, "Do you want to go back to my place?" Jack strokes her face and lips, all nervousness gone. "Let's get out of here." From the moment they walked through door 17 to the moment they eventually collapsed in exhaustion and ecstasy, they were lost in a tangle of passion and excitement, letting their curtains fall and reveal their deepest desires and longing for each other. They lay together, holding each other close. Ashley breaks their precious silence. "I can't believe how different I am than I was a few days ago. It's like I'm a whole different person, like I can breathe, and it feels so good. Thank you for saving me, Jack." Sculptor, Part 2. Jack. Jack walks timidly down the empty, dim hallway, not quite sure where he's going yet, but nervous nonetheless. He hears a slight sob from a nearby door and stops. Apartment 17. He thinks about knocking lightly, but decides against it. He turns the handle, and to his surprise, it opens. His anxiety climbs, blood pressure rises, and heart races as he thinks, "What am I doing?" He enters slowly, the sobbing getting louder. It's coming from the bathroom. He considers saying something, but no words come to his mouth. Once he's almost there, he hears a small piece of metal clattering to the floor. Nerves on fire, he slowly creeps through the bathroom door, unprepared for what he was about to see. At first, he was angry and confused. He didn't know what to do. Though, seeing her fall to the floor, almost as though someone else was controlling his body, he picked her up and took some gauze from his bag. He patched up her wounds and placed her gently in bed. The rest of the night, he spent cleaning her blood off the floor. After he rushed out of her apartment, he felt like he hadn't taken a breath since he stepped through the door the night before. He left so quickly he realized all too late that he left his bag behind. He was already on his way to work, so it was far too late to go back. All he could do was pray she wouldn't look inside. The ring of the phone made Jack's heart stop. His hands shook as he pulled out his phone and swiped to accept the call. Nervous as he was, the call went pretty smoothly. She didn't seem freaked out by him, and he even asked her to dinner. Heart racing almost as fast as his car, Jack sped downtown to the shabby apartment building. He parked outside, heart pounding, and waited for Ashley to come out. When she emerged with his heavy black bag in hand, he thought the worst until she hopped into the passenger side. "Hey, Jack, where do you want this?" He answers nervously but holding it together. "Oh, you can just throw it in the back, anywhere's fine. I don't really care." Ashley adjusts her seat. "So, where are we going?" Her casual tone eases Jack's mind. He relaxes and replies, "I thought maybe Luca Ricci?" Nervous but excited, Ashley agrees. "Sounds good. I like Italian." Jack hesitates, waiting. "Cool. You ready?" Ashley looks at him confused. "Yep." Jack looks at her unbuckled belt. "Buckle your seatbelt." Ashley gives a slight smile and reluctantly buckles her seatbelt. The date was magical. Even though he was nervous at first, everything just fell into place. All of his worries melted away the moment he saw her smile, heard her laugh. She was perfect. Almost perfect. Not quite yet, but almost. When she kissed him and said goodnight, the whole world went away. He waited at her door for what felt like hours before leaving the apartment building and heading home. He was worried when she didn't call or text the next day, but dropped everything to meet her at the mall. Left work early, didn't say a word to any of his coworkers. She was so much more important. And seeing her eyes light up when she saw that dress, she looked so happy, and seeing her try it on, wow. She looked so beautiful that Jack didn't know what to say. She was as beautiful as a Greek goddess. "Is it weird that it's a big white dress?" Ashley broke his trance. No. It's not like it's a wedding dress. She raises an eyebrow at him. "Isn't it though?" Trying to play off his staring, Jack tries to ease her mind. No, it's perfect. Buy it or I'll do it for you. Seeing her in that dress, so happy, it was all coming together. She loved it so much she wore it out of the store. Jack was eager to see the studio, learn more about her, spend as much time with her as he could while he could. And seeing her there in that dress, so beautiful. The lights glimmered off the shimmering threads and gems interlaced in her bodice, and her silhouette was perfectly framed, emphasizing her curves and profile. When they danced, they were both taken away. Jack could feel it, lost in a trance together, happy and at peace. The passion they shared was like no other. None that he'd read about in books, seen in movies, heard in stories. It was almost too much for Jack to bear. He wanted to do it right then and there, but he knew he had to wait. She needed to be ready. Entering her home for the last time, Jack knew what was coming, and he was so excited. Once they both collapsed, recovering from their passionate night together, it was Ashley who broke their peaceful silence. "I can't believe how different I am than I was a few days ago. It's like I'm a whole different person, like, I can breathe, and it feels so good. Thank you for saving me, Jack." "Ashley, you helped me so much more than I helped you." She smiles at him sweetly, and at first doesn't even notice the cold nettle blade cut deep into her abdomen. Not even so much as a gasp escaped her lips. It was harder than he thought, cutting through fabric and flesh. Jack smiles and thrusts his knife into her again, easier this time. "Now I know why I didn't let you die." Again, easier still. Ashley tries to scream, but no sound comes out, completely petrified by shock. No more comes from her than a tear falling down her face. I know why I couldn't kill you now. I thought it was ruined. I thought you doing what you did ruined everything. But it inspired me. My instincts took over, and I know what I want, what I need now. Again, effortless. Ashley can only manage a small whimper. Jack kisses her sweetly on the lips and strokes her hair. I needed you to value your life when I took it away. I needed to fix you, make you better, sculpt you before I destroyed you. Again, just like what you did, what you taught me to do, and it was better than I could have ever imagined. Again, I was so confused and lost. I had these impulses I couldn't control anymore. You gave me a purpose that I couldn't have found on my own. Thank you. Never did he feel more ecstasy than when he stabbed her for the last time. He stabbed her 17 times and waited until she took her final breath, wiping the tears from her eyes. He looked at her one last time, still in that beautiful, now bloodstained dress. Absolutely perfect. Epilogue. Jack looks at his growing wall of mementos, all of the bloody business cards with his name and number on the back.
And finally, a poem about everlasting loss.
Once upon a midnight dreary, while I pondered, weak and weary, over many a quaint and curious volume of forgotten lore, while I nodded, nearly napping, suddenly there came a tapping, as if someone gently rapping at my chamber door. "'Tis some visitor," I muttered, tapping at my chamber door. Only this, and nothing more.
Distinctly, I remember it was in the bleak December, and each separate dying ember wrought its ghost upon the floor. Eagerly I wished the morrow, vainly I had sought to borrow from my books surcease of sorrow for the lost Lenore, for the rare and radiant maiden whom the angels name Lenore, nameless here, forevermore.
And the silken, sad, uncertain, wrestling of each purple curtain, thrilled me, filled me with fantastic terrors never felt before. So that now, to still the beating of my heart, I stood repeating, 'Tis some visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door. Some late visitor entreating entrance at my chamber door. This and nothing more.
Presently my soul grew stronger, hesitating then no longer. Sir, said I, or madam, truly your forgiveness I implore. But the fact is, I was napping, and so gently you came rapping, and so faintly you came tapping at my chamber door, that I scarce was sure I heard you. Here I opened wide the door. Darkness there, and nothing more.
Deep into that darkness peering, long I stood there wondering, fearing, doubting, dreaming dreams no mortal ever dared to dream before. But the silence was unbroken, and the stillness gave no token, and the only word there spoken was the whispered word, Lenore. This I whispered, and an echo murmured back the word, Lenore. Merely this, and nothing more.
Back into the chamber turning, all my soul within me burning, soon again I heard a tapping, somewhat louder than before. Surely, I said, surely that is something at my window lattice. Let me see, then, what thereat is, and this mystery explore. Let my heart be still a moment, and this mystery explore. 'Tis the wind, and nothing more.
Open here I flung the shutter, when with many a flirt and flutter, in there stepped a stately raven, of the saintly days of yore. Not the least obeisance made he, not a minute stopped or stayed he, but with mien of lord and lady, perched above my chamber door, perched upon a bust of Pallas just above my chamber door, perched and sat, and nothing more.
Then this ebony bird beguiling my my sad fancy into smiling by the grave and stern decorum of the countenance it wore. Through thy crest be shown and shaven, thou, I said, art sure no craven, ghastly grim and ancient raven, wandering from this knightly shore. Tell me what thy lordly name is on this night's Plutonian shore. Quoth the raven, nevermore. Such I marveled this ungainly fowl to hear disclosure so plainly. Through it answered little meaning, little relevancy bore. For we cannot help agreeing that no living human being ever yet with blessing with seeing bird above his chamber door, bird or beast upon the sculptured bust above his chamber door, with such name as nevermore.
But the raven, sitting lonely on the placid bust, spoke only that one word, as if his soul in that one word he did outpour. Nothing farther than he uttered, not a feather than he fluttered, till scarcely I more than muttered, other friends have flown before. On the morrow he will leave me, as my hopes have flown before. Then the bird said, nevermore.
Started at the stillness broken by reply so amply spoken, doubtless, I said, what it utters is only stock and store, caught from some unhappy master whom unmerciful disaster followed fast and followed faster till his song one burden bore, till the dirges of his hope the melancholy burden bore of never, nevermore. But the raven, still beguiling all my fancy onto smiling, straight I wheeled a cushioned seat in front of bird and bust and door. Then, upon the velvet sinking, I betook myself to linking fancy unto fancy, thinking that this ominous bird of yore, what this grim, ungainly, ghastly, gaunt, and ominous bird of yore meant in croaking, nevermore. This I sat engaged in guessing, but no syllable expressed. For the fowl whose fiery eyes now burned into my bosom's core, this and more I sat divining, with my head at ease reclining on the cushion's velvet lining that the lamplight gloated o'er, to whose velvet violet lining, with the lamplight gloating o'er, she shall pass, ah, nevermore. Then, methought, the air grew denser, perfumed from an unseen censer, sprung by seraphim whose footfalls tinkered on the tufted floor. Wretch, I cried, thy God hath lent thee, by these angels he hath sent thee, respite, respite, and nepenthe thee from thy memories of Lenore. Quaff, oh quaff these kind nepenthes, and forget this lost Lenore. Quoth the raven, nevermore.
Prophet, said I, thing of evil, prophet still, if bird or devil, whether tempest sent, or whether tempest tossed be here ashore, desolate, yet all undaunted, on this desert land enchanted, on this home by horror haunted, tell me truly, I implore, is there a balm in Gilead? Tell me, I implore. Quoth the raven, nevermore.
Prophet, said I, thing of evil, prophet still, if bird or devil, by that heaven that bends above us, by that God we both adore, tell this soul with sorrow maiden, if within the distant Aden, it shall clasp a sainted maiden, whom the angels name Lenore. Clasp a rare and radiant maiden, whom the angels name Lenore. Quoth the raven, nevermore.
Be that word our sign of parting, bird or fiend, I shrieked upstarting. Get thee back into the tempest in the night's plutonian shore. Leave no black plume as a token of that lie that soul hath spoken. Leave my loneliness unbroken. Quit the bust above my door. Take thy beak out from my heart and take thy form off of my door. Quoth the raven, nevermore.
And the raven, never flitting, still is sitting, still is sitting on the pallid bust of Pallas just above my chamber door. And his eyes have all the seeming of a demon's that is dreaming. And the lamplight o'er him streaming throws his shadow on the floor. And my soul from out that shadow that lies floating on the floor shall be lifted never more.
Nevermore. Now you see the world is filled with terror.
Finally! Hello? Hello! There you all are. We're not dead.
What? How did you get out?
Oh, with some help from Mother.
Yeah. Mother!
Mother?
Yep. You are in so much trouble.
No!